you can't tame him. There is no one,
no one,
no one,
no one,
no one like Jesus. He has,
he has,
he has,
he has
no rival, no one,
no one,
no one,
no one,
no one like Jesus. He has,
he has,
he has,
he has
no equal. He is gentle, but you can't tame him. There is no one,
no one,
no one,
no one,
no one like Jesus. He has,
he has,
he has,
he has
no rival, no one,
no one,
no one. You can't tame him. There is no one,
no one,
no one,
no one,
no one like Jesus. He has,
he has,
he has,
he has
no rival, no one,
no one,
no one. You can't tame him. There is no one,
no one,
no one,
no one,
no one like Jesus. He has,
he has,
he has,
he has
no rival, no one,
no one,
no one. You can't tame him. There is no one,
no one,
no one,
no one,
no one like Jesus. He has,
he has,
he has,
he has
no rival, no one,
no one,
no one,
no one,
no one. You can't tame him. There is no one,
no one,
no one,
no one,
no one like Jesus. He has,
he has,
he has,
he has
no rival, no one,
no one,
no one,
no one,
no one. You can't tame him. There is no one,
no one,
no one,
no
tame him. There is no one.
There is a psalm, Psalm 96. And it says, sing to the Lord, bless his name, proclaim the good news of his salvation from day to day. Sing to the Lord, bless his name, and proclaim the good news of his salvation from day to day. Would you stand with me tonight as we just open up this night of testimony before we hear our dear brother Cletus share? He's requested one worship song, and you know, with God, you always get more than what you ask for. So we're going to just invite the Holy Spirit to minister in this place. Amen. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. Take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, Jesus, we sing. Our chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter. The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Father, we ask that tonight you break the chains off of people. You You set us free. You heal. You redefine. Lord, in fact, let your love unravel us tonight. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears. Oh, let's say that again. You unravel me. You unravel me with the melody. You surround me with the song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone. And I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Seated tonight.
Praise God.
Amen. Well, like we read at the very beginning, sing a song and bless his name and proclaim the good news of his salvation from day to day. There's a man in our crowd tonight who has been saved from quite a bit. And it's his story that we want to hear tonight, which is really not his story, but it's his story. So would you welcome our dear friend and brother in the Lord, Cletus Ninham. Come on down, brother.
Thank you. You got everything on? Yep, I think so. Hello? Hello? So, I'm starting to shake. No, I'm just teasing you. Anyway, here's the offering bucket right here, if you want. So if anybody wants, they can try it on, lift it up, pick it up, see what you think of it. And that's what we wore in Vietnam, and that was 6 months of wearing this helmet. 6 months. So my intent is not to make you laugh or cry, but to give you some insight in what a combat veteran would face. I'm giving God the glory for this, because without him, I would not be standing here today. And toward the middle of my life, I found that out. I used to think things were my luck, you know. So how do you like my glasses? Yeah, I forgot mine, so. Good evening. I want to thank Pastor Ben for giving me this opportunity to talk about my life. I grew up on the Oneida Reservation. I was the ninth child of 13. I am 76 years old. I thought life would take longer than what it did. You know, it seems like it just went by so fast. I mean, it's not over for me yet, but it's going by. It's gone by fast. We had no plumbing or electricity. We did not have running water. I would go up the hill from our house to our grandmother's house and run back down the hill with a bucket of water. So when my mom was 5 years old, she was sent to a school in Wittenberg, where she would get beatings for not being able to speak English. That is why we were never taught our Oneida language. She didn't want her children to go through the ordeal she suffered. There's a verse that says what they used to say, kill the Indian and save the man. My dad only went to the third grade. He taught himself how to play the guitar. No, I'm sorry, the violin and the drums. My mom taught herself how to play the piano and a steel guitar. That was our entertainment. For a side job during the Depression, they used to run moonshine for extra income. You didn't hear me say that, right? Okay, I went to a mission school on the reservation. I was also an altar boy until I was about 19 years old. When I was in high school, I had a job at PDQ Car Wash. I worked weekends and summers, $1.25 an hour. After high school, it was hard to find a higher paying job, so I moved to Milwaukee with my brother, Sam. I was 20 years old. My income was a lot better. So here's for you car buffs. I had three cars, a 1939 Chevrolet Coupe, a two-door, a 32 Ford with a rumble seat in the back with an Oldsmobile a flathead V8 with a 3/4-inch racing cam. I liked popping wheelies with that car. I also had a 58 white Pontiac Bonneville convertible with the Continental kit on the back. Life was getting better. Then, one day, I received a letter stating, report. I ignored it, hoping it would go away. And a few weeks later, another one appeared. It said, report or else. You know, they said other stuff in there, but yeah. I decided to report because I really didn't want to go to jail. I was to take a train out of Milwaukee to Fort Knox, Kentucky. The only car I kept was the 32 Ford, just in case I made it back from Vietnam. The first person to meet us, recruits, was a DI, that's a drill instructor. Right off the bat, he started calling us names, like knucklehead, jackass, other names I better not mention. He said, you are now GIs. That means government issue. 2 years, 1965 to 67, the Army owned me. We were told to repeat this oath. I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies and foreign and domestic, and that oath has not expired. The DI went on to tell when to sleep, when to get up, when to eat. I will train you how to kill. You will learn every small weapon the military has. You will be blindfolded, take apart, and put back together every weapon that you're trained on. You will receive a dog tag with a number on. You have 3 days to know that number. The 3 days were up. We end up going to a very small room, no windows. We were issued gas masks. Tear gas was shot into the room and canisters were thrown in. The DI came up to each of us. It was my turn. He said, Ninam, take that gas mask off. Tell me that number. You better know it, otherwise you were not able to leave that room. Our bunks had to bounce a quarter off. If not, it would be thrown on the floor. All of your bedding would be thrown. Sometimes the whole bunk would be knocked over. We all graduated. New orders, report to Fort Gordon, Georgia, AIT. We had to qualify more weapons, hand-to-hand combat, 50 caliber machine gun, shoot 1 mile away and hit a tank. I qualified expert and sharpshooter, all small weapons. Not until I was graduating, I understood what AIT really meant, advanced infantry training. In combat situations, they are the ones that go in first. We became more skilled at killing. Report to Fort Benning was a new order, jump school. Boots had to be spit shined, and even the soles had to be polished. More running everywhere we went. Even in a chow line, had to run in place. We would be lifted up in a parachute. Parachute would be opened 250 feet in the air, then dropped. We had to learn to land, called a PLF, parachute landing fall. We had to make 7 jumps, one at night, to graduate. We were all getting to know each other better and better. Is that such a word? Better and better? That's where I got the nickname, Chief. No disrespect. We received no orders. No one will have a pass or leave. You all are going to Vietnam. In San Francisco, we had a I missed a part here. We landed in Traverse in California. Only one of my friends, dad and mom, were in San Francisco, California. He had a 3-day pass. He said, "Chief, come with." I said, "I can't. No money, and I don't have a leave, a pass." He said, "What, they're gonna go to duty and send you to Vietnam?" So, the Trang Air Force Base, we landed in Vietnam. Buses were waiting to take us to the 173rd Airborne Division. On the way, we seen women in a lot going to the bathroom. Cars and buses were going by. They thought nothing of it. I thought to myself, what am I in for? We arrived at our destination. New orders, just like the military, keep changing. We were now 101st Airborne. We had to count up to 4. I knew what that was going to happen. I told my friend, "Don't stand by me. We will be separated." Number ones went to the first 327, number twos the second 37, number three the first 50 deuce, the numbers fourth, the second 502nd. You guessed it, we were separated. I haven't seen him since. We moved out to the 101st base camp at Quanang, a monastery that was abandoned. We would do search and destroy missions. That was our main purpose, seek out the enemy and destroy their strongholds and cut off their food supply. We moved to a new base camp, Phan Rang. There was hot food and showers and a real cot to sleep on. I knew things were going too good. Saddle up, only bring necessary items, pack everything else in duffel bags, and store it. Little did I know this would be a six-month seek and destroy mission. No more showers, cots, hot food. We were issued purification tablets, salt tablets. Our food would be sea rations, food in a can. I got to like the pound cake and the peaches. I cooked my food with a C4, highly explosive if you put a blasting cap on it. It would burn hot if you lit it. I hated snakes, land leeches, mosquitoes, which Vietnam had plentiful. Land leeches would be on land, dry land, it'd just come right at you. You know, they're like the bloodsuckers in the water nowadays, now in Wisconsin. This one snake we called a two-stepper. Two steps, you would be dead. Also cobras. Some of the mountains and jungles would be sprayed with a chemical called Agent Orange. Would look like a cold fall day in Wisconsin. Leaves all fall off. That was so the VC, do you know what VC means, everybody? Viet Cong, right, Viet Cong. Had no place to hide. B-52 bombers, craters were as big as this room. I'm not exaggerating that. About 10 feet deep. Napalm would be dropped. Everything in its path would be destroyed. A fire that cannot be put out. It was like a jelly that came in and was burning. Elderly woman, she had it under her foot. As soon as it would get air, it would start back up and she'd be hollering. And I didn't do anything about it. I just walked by her and kind of said, "Good for you." Because they were supplying Viet Cong. They were Viet Cong. They were killing our guys. And hatred was coming. We were airlifted to a VC stronghold. We came in hot. Bullets would be hitting all around our chopper. At least 10 feet high, the rice paddies were above the rice paddies. The pilot would holler, "Out, Out. My wife's glasses aren't working that good. I could hear the rockets and the missiles, whatever they're shooting at us, going by right by our ships, and you could just hear them going. Whew, whew. You could actually see the smoke trail going by. My rifle malfunctioned after I hit that rice paddy. I was running, didn't even hardly hit the water. I was just running, kind of like when Jesus walked on the water. But I was really running. Our battalion had all M16s with a selector switch that would be turned into full auto. Our sergeant said to me, "Come on, Chief, take your Bowie knife out and charge." Bullets would be hitting all around me, in between my legs. I could hear them whistling past my head. It was like an invisible shield that was around me. At night, it would be so dark, we could barely see 5 feet in front of us. We dug in. Foxholes, they were called. A lot of noise was coming right for us. I was a point man and a fire team leader. I would be 20 yards in front of our, sometimes a flanker, that's to the left and right side. I would position my team where the attacks would be most likely to hit us at. That noise was getting closer and louder. My team were getting trigger happy. I said, "You better not fire. Do not fire. That is too much noise to be a VC." Sure enough, a skinny black trooper came out with an entrenching tool. That's a small shovel that folds up. I looked at him. "You need to thank me for saving your life." We would sleep 1 hour on, 1 hour off. For 6 months we did that. It started to rain. That was the start of the monsoon. It was my turn to sleep. We had our own foxholes. I felt warm. I opened my eyes. Water was right up to my chest. And that was my bath for the month. We were on the trail as wide as a city street. All of a sudden, we were getting machine gun fire. It was our own chopper. I could see the gunner. He was firing on us. I was going to shoot him if he didn't stop. My sergeant said, "Don't, Chief, don't." Lewis, a black trooper, his backpack with his C rations was hit. He started to holler, I'm hit. I start laughing and laughing. I couldn't stop laughing. I said, "You're not hit? That's only your backpack, the C rations. Because there was so much meat and other stuff in there." He had his back. It was funny. The VC commander said of the 101st Airborne, I quote, "warned their men to avoid the 101st at all costs because they were sure to lose any engagement with them." I would carry 20 mags and a lot of hand grenades, 2 canteens of water, a knife, it's 72 rocket launcher, a small Bible, carried it on my helmet, then my pocket, hoping that would stop a bullet, because I heard about a lot of people getting shot in the helmet and bullet going around and coming out through their head. So that's why I carried a small Bible there, thinking I never opened the Bible. More ammo than food I carried. I knew how to get food to survive. I used to play cowboys and Indians with brothers and friend Richard next door. I always wanted to be the cowboy because they never lost. We would hide in trees. That actually helped me in Vietnam. From their experiences, I could tell when something was out of place. Charlie Company. First 327 was making us sweet. We called ourselves Cold Steel Cobra because the VC was called Charlie. Into this VC village, a small dirt street, was more like a path, bamboo and brush in front. We'd go inside, the hooches check for supplies in VC. The VC would abandon their hooches. Food still hot, we would eat it sometimes. It was rat. One of my friends still in touch, first thing he says, would say to me, "Had any rat lately, Chief?" On the trail, we were search and destroy, one part like this and the other one back like this, and one part was getting too far ahead. Anyway, the one in the brush were way back because the ones on a trail were easy walking. Anyway, the one trooper went inside. As he was coming back out, the barrel. First, the other trooper seen just the barrel coming out. He thought it was a VC and he blasted 20 rounds into him. I had a brother in World War II, two in Korea, and one that was not deployed. Harold told me not to make friends. When they die, it would hurt. And he was right. It did hurt. We would be on forced marches all day and all night. Our machine gunner dropped his M60 about 25 yards back. I was so tired, my helmet fell off. We took a break for a half hour so the machine gunner could catch up. It's getting light out now. I was wondering why I was so comfortable. I got up, here it was, a grave sunken in. That was one of the best nights I had. Our company was always on the move. We're known as nomads. My socks, underwear would get so rotten, they fell off. It seemed like we were always in rice paddies. On the trail, the VC would have traps set. This one was called a Bouncing Betty. It would come up waist high, then explode. Holes like a foxhole with 3-foot stakes like spears would be sticking up if you walk on that trail and fall in that trap. We came across a real strong one. It would be destroyed with fire. Someone in my company wanted me to scalp the dead VC. I said, no, I don't do that. There was a VC on a burial platform, high up, kind of like the Sioux do their burials. I had to make sure he was dead. I was gonna shoot him. Instead, I set him on fire. I wanted to make sure he was dead. At this point, I was becoming harder. As I was leaving that area, I seen a big, big wicker basket. I mean, it was bigger and wider than that piano, with a lid on it. I was going to open up on it with 20 rounds. I was just gonna blast away on it. And something down deep told me not to do it. I never take off lids or open doors because of booby traps. You know, they'll explode on you if you open them. I took it off. There inside was a young VC woman with a newborn baby and an older man that they put their hands over their face and they thought I was gonna shoot them, and they were shaking their heads and crying. I told them, I went shh, and I shut the lid. We were getting ready to leave, and I was the last one to leave, so nobody messed with him. A VC, he was Next day, we were getting fired upon again. We captured a VC. He was wounded. One of our lieutenants said, "Kill him." I was 4 feet away. I looked the VC in the eyes and seemed to say, "Don't kill me, don't." And someone in the back of the Rosha came up and shot him in the head. Those eyes would torment me for a very long time. Our company received a call. Our sister battalion, 1st, 2nd, 327, was getting hit hard. We landed. Area was called Tuiwa. 30 to 40 of our troopers were in body bags. I walked to my left and seen hundreds of dead VC, like the Holocaust, in a windy trench. I missed the page. A windy trench, as far as you could see, just like an S, just bodies and bodies, as high as you could see. And they were all naked. They were stripped of their clothing. Vietnam gets very hot, deterioration sets in fast, rotting, maggots were all over them. That smell would not leave me for years. I had a hard time eating meat and rice. I had a hurt in me. It wouldn't go away. I just sat on my helmet, feeling numb and angry at the same time. No young person should go through, or anyone. They say war is hell. How true. The next day we hit that mountain of Tuiwa. I had a new M16. That one malfunctioned on me too. The sergeant was near me, said, "Chief, just point, make like you're firing bullets." They would be hitting all around me. Seemed like they liked picking on me, I don't know. These bullets would just be flying all around. Anyway, my CO received a letter from the Red Cross ordering me to write home. What was I going to tell them? My friends are getting killed. I'm living day by day. Next, we were in a straight line, which we should have never done. Our men were getting killed and wounded. Our lieutenant got hit. We were in this big open field. My friends and sergeant, his name is Randy. "Let's go get him, Chief." He took the head and I took the feet. Bullets hitting all around us. You could just feel them just hitting next to you. You could feel them go by your pant legs and in your head. My sergeant got hit right through the knee, a small target. I used to wonder why I never got hit in the back, which was a big target. I bandaged him up, took him to the rear, about 200 yards. I went back into the firefight. On the way back in, our second lieutenant was being carried out. Third lieutenant, he was dead. His intestines were all hanging out. I'm trying to tell you what a combat veteran seen and did. I helped carry him out. Then I went back in the firefight. It was starting to let up. Next 2 days, we received a call. A Chinook was able to carry 20 men, went down in non-call. We needed to go secure and recover. It was split in half, body parts missing, laying up. The whole left side of that Chinook was gone. There was nothing there, just body parts. And the right side, these were all new replacements. They were strapped in, plus the two pilots. They were all puffed up from the heat like a chicken, how you roast a chicken. But their clothes were, uniforms were not burned. They were all dead. After that, we had info, an American trooper in the mountains of Nan Ko. We trapped our way up a foot at a time. I mean, just chopping because it's so thick. My hands were hurting so bad. I could barely hold a machete. We were a half hour too late. On that mountain, it was starting to get dark. Five of us were walking to the check out the VC camp. All of a sudden, I heard a loud explosion. I was falling in slow motion. I called out to God. I had holes in me as big as my fist. The blood was coming out fast. I was hitting them seven places. I told the closest one to me, come and bandage me. He was froze, and so were the other ones. They couldn't move. I started to bandage myself, and the bleeding and the pain, it stopped instantly. When the medic arrived, he gave me a shot of morphine, which I did not need because I was not in pain. The choppers were coming to airlift us out. The wind was getting stronger. I was put in a harness, like a seat, like a straps. It wasn't really a seat, it was strapped in. The wind was picking up and he started to drift into the bamboo trees. They had to drop me about treetop high, otherwise I would be crushed. Three of us were wounded. It was raining now. We had to put two ponchos together to make a tent. The pilot said they would be back in the morning. The company had to chop a LZ, a landing zone. Medics were out of morphine. I could hear the screams. All night, one trooper had his shoulder almost got tore off. The other trooper, his legs was almost off, and his other leg was torn up. My medic kept on slapping me. He said, Chief, I gotta keep you awake. And I said, I'm not in pain, no bleeding. I think he thought I was losing, my blood was all gone, I think. Anyway, I told him, knock it off. Next day, they took us to a MASH unit. The sergeant was having his leg cut off, died. I felt something warm in my boot. It was on an operating table. The doctor said, we have to cut your boot off. I said, no, no, no. Because they were brand new boots, the first ones I had, jungle boots. And he cut them off. I had a hole right through my left heel, and I had blood in her all night. So do you think that's an act of God? Or what? You know, I should have bled to death. I spent a month in a field hospital. I had to finish my tour back in Van Rang. Well, actually, they shipped me out to close to the front. I was a mail clerk, like, and I had a great big tent all by myself and a cot. And I was the person that had to write moms and dads the letter, deceased, and send all them letters back home. And at the time, I wasn't a Christian, but they had care packages. I said, well, they might feel better if I ate the food and stuff, because otherwise they'd think their son never got it, which they never did. We were ordered to saddle up anyone that could hold a weapon. Our company, 1327, was getting overrun at Dock Toll. We took it back. Then I don't remember getting on a jet to come home. I made it home. I had a 30-day leave. I ended up at the VA hospital in Milwaukee. My leg was just so swollen I could hardly walk. They marked me AWOL, absent without leave. Anyway, they got verification from the VA hospital in Milwaukee that I was in their hospital, and they gave me another 30 days. I finished my time at Fort Campbell, Kentucky. I used to do jumps and still finished doing jumps, and they were doing stuff there, making me go on KP, and I just said I had enough. I went and got a doctor's excuse, exempt from all physical or KP or anything, guard duty. I mean, they could have let me home in Vietnam, they could have, but they made me finish my tour. I knew about God, but I didn't know him. After the bullets stopped flying, I faced physical challenges because of my injuries suffered in Vietnam. I faced racism because of my native heritage. I faced social hatred because I was involved in an unpopular war. When I arrived home, Sweet Home, I missed Chili John's, if anybody knows about that. My mom's home cooking, homemade bread, and it's called Indian corn soup. Indian corn soup is the, we're the tribe that, Oneidas, that helped George Washington at Valley Forge. Did anybody know that? Us Oneidas are the ones that helped him. We were in every war, from the Revolutionary to the present wars. All Oneidas were, most of them were in it. Anyway, when I got home, my hands would shake when I'd drink water or eat. I was missing something in my life, and I really didn't know. You know, when God saved me in Vietnam physically, you know, I said, I want to be a witness. I want to be a witness for you when I get back, for all the other Vietnam veterans that died there. I want to show them that, hey, it was worth it. Anyway, 1969, I went to church 2 days a year, Christmas and Easter. From better to worse, 1976, our daughter died at 4 months. I drove an 18-wheeler and I was on the road in California, and I was blaming myself, the emotion and the physical pain that I was going through. I would lay in bed and cry. I did not want to be around people. I was having dreams, the same one over and over. Flashbacks of the things I went through in Vietnam, the trauma. 1979, my wife left me. I'm gonna talk about my first wife a little bit. I hope my new wife don't get jealous. Anyway, 79, my wife left me. She went to Reno, Nevada. I called her a few times. I said, we can make this work. And so I moved out to Reno. There was no change. I used to truck through San Jose, California. I would say, who in their right mind would want to live here? I told my ex-wife, I was offered a job hauling Chevy pickup trucks out of a plant in Fremont, California. Anyway, I would have her read the Bible to me. It was hard for me to pick it up. Long story short, we moved to San Jose, California. So don't ever say you're not gonna do that. She said, I hate you, and was leaving for the third time. And that was the final time, and not coming back. That night, I picked up my .44 and loaded one bullet in it. This went on all night. voice said, what is this going to do to your son? See, we become selfish when things don't go our way. We become selfish. So I took the bullet out, walked into the courtyard. It was morning in the month of June, 81. And my neighbor, anyway, she was one of them persons that was, she'd come out and talk about Jesus and how much he loves you. And anyway, my wife and I, before she left, we went to a restaurant, and this one lady came, waitress came out, said, the Lord is telling me to tell you that somebody loves you. And I said, what a nut. Yeah, what a nut. Anyway, I didn't listen. I said, sure, we should go see. She could see me through the window anyway. She asked me if I read that, read this book, read this. This is what I usually carry around now. So if anybody wants any one of them at the end. I said, sure. So she said, did you do what I said? I said, yes. And she said, why don't you come to church with me next Sunday with my husband and I? I said, okay. See, nobody ever said that to me. Nobody asked me about being born again, asking Jesus into your life. Nobody. They approached my ex-wife, but they never approached me. Anyway, we went to this church. It's called the Cathedral. It was a cathedral, a big Los Gatos Christian church. 4,000 people one service, 3,000 the next, and 2,000 something last service. Anyway, I said, I got to get out of here. I don't see any crosses. I need to get out. This is a cult or something. Anyway, sure enough, that lady and her husband took me right back to that same church. Anyway, I accepted Christ into my life, and the things that this was getting me down was just it was like a darkness, a different person. I'm a different person standing here right now. You don't want to know me before. I used to have the same dream over and over for years, falling down this big pit. It looked like a volcano, red and dark. Just before I hit the ground, I'd wake up and I'd be all sweaty, and I haven't read the Bible, remember now, so I didn't know this was called hell. I would wake up just before I'd hit. I had so much unforgiveness, bitterness, unforgiveness, you know, and fits of rage, anger. You know, people would say something to me, I'd fly off the handle. I carried a .44 pistol around with me, my backup, my equalizer, I called it. I didn't care how big you were or what. You mess with me, you're not going to come out. That's how I was. That's how the attitude I had. I mean, I would get in a fight with a blink of an eye. This one time, this black family lived above us. I'm not picking on blacks, but this is the way it is. All right, they lived above us, and I know he stole my rims off of my truck because we had a parking lot in California, and I know he had it, or he had somebody done. And I said, he said, there, now you got a permanent parking spot. So I went in the house and I took my .44 and I put it right to the roof where he was walking. And my wife said, are you nuts? He said, you're gonna shoot him? I said, yes. He said, but he's family. I said, I'm gonna shoot them too. See, that's how much rage, you know, Satan, when he's got a hold of you, that's what will happen to you if you don't watch that. You know, the forgiveness and bitterness, it just wouldn't go away until I accepted Christ into my life. And it was just like something just clean came in through me. It's just like it just burnt it out. Forgiveness is like burning down your house to get rid of a rat. You know, this is your house. That's what I'm talking about. This is your house. It's like burning that down to get rid of a rat. You're not going to be the same if you do not forgive. It's like drinking poison, hoping the other person's going to die. When you have that much rage and bitterness, hatred will destroy you. It almost destroyed me. If we do not forgive, the Bible says, you will not be forgiven. Can sin enter into heaven? Can it stay there, rather? It can't. So if you have unforgiveness about your family members, you better make amends. You better get it right. Your brothers, your sisters, your mom, wherever it goes, wherever it is, old friends, forgive them. Forgive the government. I had to do that. I had to forgive our government because of what they did. They neglected us, Vietnam veterans. They sent us out to pasture with a bad taste in our mouth, hoping we'd go away. And I had that revenge on them. I didn't want nothing to do with them. I never wore any Vietnam stuff. Nobody knew I was a veteran. Nobody. Not even my wife and son. They never seen me in this stuff. But after years, in 2000, I think it was 2006, my relatives, my brothers and sisters, and they said, how come you don't wear any Vietnam hats? And I just didn't give them an answer because I had bitterness yet. It was still there. It was still there, even though I asked Jesus to come into my life and forgiveness and the cleanness, but our root was still there down deep. Anyway, I started in 2008 wearing Vietnam veteran stuff. I'm trying to focus here at my wife's glasses. They just. You do not. We have a choice to choose to live in the past with all the regrets and sorrows. There are a lot of weights that stop us from going into the present and future. We are carrying a lot of baggage around with us. Some of us are trapped in the past. We're not getting over it. Forgive. Resentment, hopelessness, anger. We cannot walk backwards into the present and future. First, we need to forgive ourselves and others. Sometimes, old wounds that are infected have to be reopened in order to be healed. Like a band-aid, it just covers something up that has hurt you. Forgiveness, I want this to sink into everybody. So you want deliverance from this? Some people are not getting healed because of this. Forgiveness heals the wound. Forgetting heals the scars. Unforgiveness will give you a heart of stone. God wants you to have a heart of flesh. You know, how can people say, well, I got PTSD. You're not surrendering. You know, you can't believe the Bible and receive all these other junk, you know, bitterness and all that. You got to let it go. You cannot. What does John 8:32 say? What does that say? Anybody have their Bible? What's up? That was supposed to be 32, but that's okay too. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Now do John 8:36 now. Therefore, the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. So how can you say you got PTSD if you don't believe what the Bible says? See, I believe what the Bible says. I don't have PTSD. No, I don't. It's not of God. If it's not of God, don't accept it. Accept the things of God. you know, 1 Timothy 2:8. Well, can you bring that up? 1 Timothy 2:8. What is that saying? Somebody read that. I can't hear you. So is that telling us to lift our holy hands when we come into the house of God to worship? So there's your answer right there. Lift up your hands. Surrender it. See that word wrath? That means boiling over anger, fits of rage. See, I had that. And doubting, it's a slow boiling anger type. And doubting, it's like doubting, that word means you're trying to go backwards and forward at the same time. That's what doubting means. See, we're trying to do that when it's sin in our life. Sin cannot stay in heaven. So are you going to be able to stay? Revelation 20:11. That one talks about, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Did you ever see that picture of Jesus with knocking on the door, no doorknob? See, that's your heart. You need to open that door and let him in. He's not going to force his way in. You got to open it. So that's what that means. And Revelations 3:20. Oh, you got it right. Can you go with Revelations 20, verse 11? I didn't write that down on my, but it's there. Revelations 20, verse 11 to 15. Can you bring it up? So somebody read it again for me, please. Keep reading, all the way to the end.
And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged according to their works, by the things which were written in the books.
Keep going. The last one.
And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire.
So is that saying that we're all going to go to heaven and this? No. We're all going to sin, cannot stay there. We're going to be judged. See, if your name, there's the word sin. If your name is not written in the Lamb's book of life, see, there's books in heaven, and one is the book of life. And how you get your name in there? Would you like to know that? Okay. Okay. First off, it says, anyone that calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Anyone. And if you deny Jesus, this is scriptural, if you deny him before men, he will deny us before his Father. So to get your name written in the Lamb's book of life, you need to ask Christ into your life for forgiveness. And it's very easy to do that. See, I'm trying to think. I believe it's Isaiah 35. Anyway, it talks about a road, a highway to heaven. Isaiah 35. I should have gave you that before I... It says, there's a highway. There used to be a song like that too. Maybe Pastor Ben will sing that. It says, there's a highway to heaven. Only the, can you see it? Can you?
A highway shall be there, and a road, and it shall be called the highway of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it, but it shall be for others. Whoever walks the road, although a fool, shall not go astray.
Amen. So are you on that highway? How many is on that highway of holiness? How many want to get on that highway? Anybody out there want to get on that highway? So the ones, see, it says, you got to acknowledge Jesus before men. A lot of pastors say, bow your head. But I say, look me in the eyes. Look me in the eyes. Because you're going to confess it before men. And then God is going to he's going to be confessed before him. Just say after me. Say, Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God. You died on a cross for all my sins. I ask you right now, come into my life. Forgive me of all my sins and be Lord of my life. See how easy that was? A free gift. Why do you want to gamble with your life? Why do you want to gamble with your life? If you believe that prayer, you are written down in that Lamb's Book of Life. See, it's better to believe that there's a God when you die than find out when you die that there is a God. See, there's judgment. There's judgment. I don't want to be judged. So that's why I repented. I repent every day. I have to. Of the world. We're in the world. It says we're not going to be of the world. You know, all these things all around us, they're going to disappear. We're new creations now if you accepted that. You know, Romans 8:1, it says, there's no more condemnation. That means there's no more judgment against you. You know, why do you want to go around being judged? Why do you want to hang on to that garbage when you can let it go and get rid of it? You know, deliverance is for you today. You want to be set free from anger, fits of rage, and like I was? Don't end up like I was. You know, I used to be. Anyway, for the best part of it, I hope I didn't make my first wife mad. Anyway, I'd like you to meet my first and second wife back there. We're married. We were remarried in 83. A long story short, I was in Long Beach, California, and her and our son Cletus was here in Wisconsin. And the Lord told me, he said, go back to Wisconsin. I said, nope. He said, go back to Wisconsin. I didn't want to. I really didn't want to because I had a good job. I was making close to $2,000 a week and driving truck. I used to haul cars. Anyway, and finally I did. I got there and you want to hear how we first met? we met in a teenage bar. Anyway, she didn't like me. She didn't like me. we kept on going out and finally she asked me to marry her. And I said, okay, we'll make it work. Ask her. Anyway, the second one, I asked her to marry me, and she said, no. And I did it again, and finally she did. She said yes, and so we got married in 83, May. Seemed like everything happens for me on May 16th or the 16th. 16th of April, I was born. May 16th, I got wounded. March 16th. Anyway. Deliverance. So, do you want to hang on to that stuff or get rid of it? So, it's up to you. It's up to everybody. You know, you got a choice to choose, and choose life, I hope. So if anyone, by the way, am I running out of time? Am I on time? Good. Anyway, the Lord sent us both to Bible college, and we've been in the healing ministry ever since. I think it was 92, and I think Chrissy Dunsmore there, she was our keyboard player, and Carol and a couple other people were our singers. And we'd go and minister and help bring our son Cletus, and we went and ministered at a prison, the state prison. Anyway, we went into that prison. Anyway, and I knew the, what is his name again? Vanderbar. Start with a B. Anyway, that's not important right now. Anyway, the guards there would not let us in because we were practicing how to set up our equipment. And they said, the guards came in, you cannot take your keyboard and guitars in there. No, no, you can't. Anyway, I said, call Bertrand. Name came back. Call Bertrand. Anyway, they called him, and he came. He said, let them people through. And the big doors opened, and I was never so nervous in my life when them big doors start crashing. I mean, them doors were high as the ceiling, and they crashed down. Anyway, he said, you have 1 hour. He said, you're going to do 2 hour services. He lied to us. He gave us 1 hour with both groups of 200 men. And I had to put my keyboard player in back of me and my wife. I just said, stand back there. A bunch of guys in prison. Anyway, somebody was doing a message and I had to cut him off. I told my son to take over. Anyway, he started doing it. And then we did the altar call and all 200 of them came running up. They just like, the anointing was so strong in there. They all accepted the Lord, every one of them. And we were praying for him. The guard was saying, all right, you need to leave, you need to leave. I was praying for this one little black guy. He had AIDS. And he said, well, God, answer that prayer. I said, hey, he knows your heart. He'll answer you. I said, but you got to leave. You got to leave. And we were ushered out. Anyway, we went to other churches. And we went to Methodist, Lutheran, Catholic, Episcopalians. See, my answer for Pastor Ben when he confronts a Catholic, all you have to do is say, God loves Catholics too. And that opens their heart. Don't ever argue with anybody. Don't ever cut their religion down. Yeah. Just give them love. You know, that's what we're supposed to do, love one another and love them. And it works. We went to this one place and it was called the Wilderness Church and up by Gresham, up that way. Anyway, we talked about the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit started moving in that place. And he said, I'd like you to come back next week. He said, but don't talk about the Holy Spirit. So we had to turn him down. He said, no, we can't do that. So we've been doing this for quite a long time, and so we've seen people healed and set free, delivered. We've seen a person look like a snake. She was going around like a snake, and people would levitate off their beds, and it just come against the spirit of witchcraft. And so if you have anything that's hard to let loose in your life, why don't you come forward? Come forward and I'll have the elders and the pastor pray for you. I think this is the end of my message. Come forward. Healing, you need healing? Sometimes, I'm not saying all the time, I'm saying sometimes sin will keep us from being healed, but not all the time. So, Pastor, you wanna pray on it?
And worship the Lord for a couple minutes. And Cletus, I would love for you to take some liberty and pray and minister, and some of the other ministers that are here tonight. You know, you can join in and pray and worship too.
Anybody come up?